Welcome, everyone. Thank you so much for being here today for our second iteration of program, a live stream event hosted by David Zwirner Gallery. For those of you who don't know who we are, my name is Helen Molesworth, and I'll be your host. And we are fortunate enough today to be with Portia Zvavahera, who is coming to us from her studio in Harare in Zimbabwe. And I just want to let everyone know that I'm fortunate enough to be in a room with two very recent paintings by Portia behind me. Crying Belly is this one here. And then this one is called I Can See You, but it also has a title in Shona. Can you pronounce the Shona title, because I can't wrap my my American mouth around all those consonants together. Oh, such a beautiful title. Thank you so much. So I thought maybe, you know, we've only spoken once just before very quickly, and I thought maybe what we could do is just something I would like to introduce you to your new American audience. So one of the questions I like to ask people is, what was the cultural backdrop of your childhood? Did you grow up with art in your home? Did your family play music? Did you go see movies? Were there pictures? What was the texture of your cultural life as a child?
As a child in my primary school, my mother was a hairdresser. So sometimes I would just watch her do her stuff. And this other day she was trying to do her hair and I said, I can do this. And then I did it, and she was very, very surprised that I know how to do it, and she didn't even teach me. So I think that's how it started. And when I was going to my primary education, there were times that I didn't have a satchel, like a backpack. So I would make my own bags with, you know, those cereal boxes. I would stick pictures of food or fashion and cover it with plastic and make a bag. And then at school also, they would choose me like to draw. We were doing like general paper, like content, this subject that there's a story like about Joseph in the Bible, and then they would ask you to draw what you have understood about the story. And then I would draw, and then each time when there's prize giving day, they would put my work there, because they didn't have art as a subject at primary school. Yeah, so it was something that was recognized during that time with parents and the headmasters and everything. And then I went to Form One. That's where I started doing art now as a subject, as a practical subject. And then, yeah, I think that's how it started.
That was such an amazing run of images. First, you already having this skill in your hands in terms of working with your mother in the hairdressing salon, and then you already doing some collaging on the exterior of the cereal box, and then also you having a special role in school, because I think artists have a very special role in society to make the picture that other people can't make, to help them understand something. So even in that short answer are so many things that then come to fruition for you as an adult. That was really remarkable to me. As a child, when your pictures went up on the wall, how did that make you feel?
because I wasn't that good at school. I was an average person at school. So this was my thing. Even when it comes to sewing, I've always had a good hand in sewing at school. So this was what I had passion since the primary school. And to my surprise, when I went to secondary school, I wanted to do food and nutrition just because my sisters were coming with food at school after their lessons at school. So I wanted to inherit that. But it didn't work out for me because I came late that day when we were choosing which practical to do. And then all the teachers refused that I take one of the practical subjects. Then I went to the headmistress. Then the headmistress just came with me to this, because fashion, the class where fashion was done was just close to the headmistress class, but she just passed through that and went to arts. And then she just said, take this child. And there I was. She was angry. At first, the teacher was angry that I went and reported it to the headmistress. But then she gave me a picture of a bed to copy from. And then I did just exactly in the book. And she was surprised and happy about having a student like me.
That's amazing. So you basically then, you could draw from the time you were a child. I mean, it's a gift that you were born with.
Yeah, I could draw, but then, you know, that time you don't really know what you are doing. You're just expressing yourself and you don't know if you can take that as a career. You are just doing stuff. You know, even when I was in secondary school, I didn't know that I could actually take the art as a career. And we didn't have opportunities to go to the National Gallery and to look for art and stuff like this because we didn't know. So, yeah, that time I wanted to just do maybe graphic designing just because I can be creative. That's what I wanted to do. But when I finished school now, I had lots of things about there's a National Gallery. And I went there to see, and then that's how it started.
So how old do you think you were when you first went to the museum?
17.
17. Yeah. Uh-huh. And what do you remember most from those early visits to the museum? Like, did you think, I want to be here? Like, did you imagine that you could be on the wall like the other objects in the museum?
I never imagined myself as an artist and with my paintings on the walls, because what I saw for me was just too much for me. I couldn't draw that, because at school we were doing mostly observation, like fruits, tree leaves, pods, and you know, those tiny little things, that's what we were drawing, and birds and stuff like this. So seeing a human being in a painting, for me, this was such a huge thing.
And then when you ended up going to art school, I'm curious if you could tell me a little bit about what art school in Zimbabwe is like. In the United States, it's very much structured on the crit. So, you know, you make work as the student, and then it's in the center of the room, and everyone talks about it, your fellow students, your teachers, and that's really where the majority of the teaching takes place. But I wondered, what was your course of study like?
There was like a live figure. We would do live figure, a person sitting there. We are drawing, And then after that, like around 12:30, around lunch hour, then we would put our drawings, displaying our drawings, and then we start the critic. But if you have something to say on the drawing, you say it, and people used to really laugh at each other because of the drawings which were not so good. So you would pull yourself to just make a beautiful drawing. Yeah, but for me at first it was so difficult because I was coming from a girls' school, and then now I'm here with so many boys in the class, and we were only two girls. So it was difficult. I was very shy, and yes, that time was difficult for me, but thank God.
I can imagine that would be difficult in the U.S., the majority of students in art school are actually women. So it's interesting that the gender difference that you're describing is not very common here. So that must be quite intense to, especially if you came from a girls' school, to all of a sudden be navigating that. That sounds like a lot.
Yeah, it was too much for me.
Yeah. Well, it might have been too much for you, but you seem to have come through it very, very strongly. One of the things I wanted to talk to you about your work is so, it has a lot of different layers in it, as you know. And I wondered if, and I see that this is kind of great because behind you, it looks like you have two big paintings that are in process. And behind me, we have two paintings that are complete. And I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about the process of how you make the work. For instance, do you start with a preparatory drawing? Do you draw first on the canvas, or do you just begin painting right away?
I draw first. I take from my sketchbooks. I make the sketch. I don't use a projector. I just draw just looking at my sketchbook and drawing onto the canvas. And then I start the process. So the process is like making designs at the same time I'm painting. So I have to think of which design I need to put on the canvas, and then I start. So sometimes it's just the sketch. I leave it for a while so I can come up with whatever I want to produce out there. And then once I know what to do, then I start.
And by designs, do you mean how you print on the canvas? Because I know you make a kind of lino cut that then gets printed, you sort of rubbing the print on the canvas. And I love this combination of printmaking and painting that come together in your work.
Mm-hmm. So with printmaking added onto the painting, I have to know when to put it and why, where exactly, what color I should put behind, in the background and on top. Because sometimes when you just do it randomly, the print won't come out nicely. So I have to think of the colors or which I'm going to use underneath the painting, or I print before, or I print in between the painting. So it just depends. Like on the painting behind you with the yellow.
Yeah.
I first did my batik and everything and the colors and everything. Then I decided what color to put on the print.
Right. So you use the word batik, and that is really the the printing that you do in the paintings has such a strong correlation to fabric and the history of fabric, and especially the way fabric has moved between Africa, North America, and the UK. I mean, that incredible circle of trade that we know historically has been so transformative for the world. Are you thinking about textiles in that way? Are you thinking about them in terms of transatlantic trade? Are you thinking about them in terms of domestic space, in terms of pattern and decoration? What role does that play for you?
In my work, batik style came when I was in London. I had bought maize flour. And then I knew if I leave this, nobody was going to use it. So I started researching about art in Zimbabwe during that time. And I was so fascinated with batik. And also at school, I did textiles. We did everything, like ceramics, textiles, and everything. But because with textiles, I was not strong enough to tie and dye the cloth. The teacher was like, "No, Portia, you're too lazy to do it." So I got discouraged and I just had to give up on it. And then, so it was just a way of me trying to find a way I can put textiles also into my work. So I tried batik, used that maize flour onto the paintings, and it worked out well for me. And then later on, just discovering beeswax and started using beeswax.
I've read a few interviews with you and watched a few videos on like YouTube that you have given. And I know that you talk a lot about the imagery in your paintings, which often has these sort of forms within forms. In the painting, this painting here, you can see these owls. You could see their little feet on the bottom. And you talk about how this imagery comes to you in your dreams, and that many of these paintings are dream imagery. You talk about keeping a notebook with drawings from your dreams in the notebook. And I wonder if you could just talk a little bit about your dreaming. So, did you dream like this as a child? Did you begin to dream like this as an adult? Did you always keep, when did you start writing down your dreams? How often do you dream? I ask these questions partly, I think, because I'm a little envious, because I very rarely remember my dreams. And when I do, they have a great force for me. And so this idea that you dream so regularly, I'm quite fascinated. And I just wonder if you could share a little bit about that with us.
Dreaming, it was just part of my life growing up, because my grandmother believed so much in dreams. So she wakes up every morning, she tells you your dreams, that I was dreaming of such, you know. She would tell you about a dream and the dream would just come true. Even my mother, she does that as well. So it's something that I grew with. And most people around me were like that. So it was something that I could not ignore at all. And we also started like sharing dreams every time in the morning. And it was actually very embarrassing to wake up with nothing. She would ask you, why are you not dreaming? You know, because you're supposed to grab something from the sleep, you know. So each time you sleep, you want to get the dreams, you know. You want to take something so you wake up and tell your grandma something about what you have dreamed. So it was something that grew in me. And doing art was somehow a way that allowed it to for me to realize that I have this information that I have, which I need to put down so I don't forget these things. Because sometimes these dreams, they keep wanting you every time. So it ended up as a healing process, so that I when I put it down, I paint it, I'm talking with the dream, I'm speaking to it, I'm praying about it, and eventually it comes out.
That's incredible. When did you start? First off, I love that it was bound up with your grandmother. My grandmother was very, very special to me in my childhood. So I love it when people talk about their grandmothers. I think it's like one of the most special human relationships is the relationship you have with your grandmother. When was your grandmother artistic at all? Like, you talked about your mother being a hairdresser. Did your grandmother make things as well?
My grandmother, we just know she goes into the field. She is doing plowing and vegetables and everything in the field.
Right.
But what she loved to do was to go to church, visit people who are sick. That's what she loved to do. But now that she's old, she's not doing that anymore.
Right. Yeah. So when did you start keeping a notebook for your dreams?
I don't really remember, but I think in the middle of my career, because the dreams kept coming, like so many of them. So sometimes in one night I would have three dreams and then I forget the other one. So I yet to record everything so I don't lose anything.
And when you record them, do you record them as a drawing or do you record them with language as a story?
Sometimes I write a short story about it so I don't forget in years to come. Sometimes I just make a sketch just like that. But mostly I do make a sketch in the night.
In the night?
In the night, yes. And write a little about the dream so I don't forget about it that much.
And your paintings have such an extraordinarily vibrant, colorful palette. So I have to ask you, do you dream in color?
No. No, I dream black and white. I don't see color in the dream. And when I'm painting, I don't know where it comes from. It's just right there. I don't think about color. I don't have any definitions about colors. I just take whatever I have from me, from within me, because usually when I'm painting now, it's the emotions that I got from the dream that I want to transfer the energy to the painting. So I think the energy brings out the colors on the paintings.
I have to say, as someone who does not make pictures, that's extraordinary to me that because your color sensibility is so special and so refined, the idea that you're just doing that's just flowing through you is really that's quite remarkable. because it looks like you've laid out all the colors in advance and that you understand how they're going to relate to one another. Do different colors have assigned meanings for you? Like, does purple always kind of feel the same way? Or does the color change as the feelings in the dream change for you?
The colors, they keep changing because of because the dreams are not always the same. They are also changing. So also the emotions and the feeling, and also the day also makes the painting change. And also what I'm looking at, like things that surrounds me, also they also contribute to which color I use.
Right.
Yeah, sometimes I'm using the color that I'm wearing and I'm surprised, why am I using this color? I don't like this color, but because I'm wearing it, sometimes it just comes.
So your paintings, for me, this is my experience of them, are, they're like a dream in that they do things that are opposite from one another. So on the one hand, they're very beautiful and very seductive, and they are also kind of scary to me sometimes. Like, there is something, you know, that makes me, like, I'm drawn to them, but then I'm also like, oh, wow, that's dark. You know, these are really... This imagery is a bit threatening or menacing sometimes. And then other times the imagery is very enveloping, like very, you know, feelings of plenty and safety. I guess I wonder about your dreams and that darker sensibility, that sense of things being threatening, things being dangerous. Our associations of the night, you know, the night is a time of great revelry and partying, but the night is also a time when things can go wrong, right? And I wonder just how do you balance all of that in the work?
I don't think about, you know, it's actually great that you said that you get different emotions from the painting, different energies from the paintings. I also get different energies from my dreams. And say you saying that, it means a lot, because it means I've managed to transfer some of the energies that I get from my dreams. And those dreams, sometimes they are just nightmares. And at night, you just wake up and you're like, what? Where was I? You know, it's scary. You are actually happy that you are alive, and you just came back from where you've been. I don't know where. So yeah, it's great that you say that, because sometimes, you know, I have my daughter, she's also having those dreams, and at the same time with my dreams, they connect at night. So sometimes nights can be very scary, can be very, and we just wake up and we don't know, wow, what we should do, because she's seeing this woman haunting her and grabbing her food and something like this, and I'm seeing this woman trying to take my child. So some nights are good, some nights are just crazy, some nights, yeah, that's I don't know if I've answered you.
No, you have. I mean, there's this in one of your other interviews where I was watching, you say, you know, where do we go when we're dreaming? And I wrote that phrase down in my notebook because I was very moved by it, moved by this idea that sleep is still, even as a grown-up, sleep is always such a strange space, you know? there's this great hip hop artist and, you know, named Nas, and in one of his most famous songs, he says, sleep is the cousin of death, you know, and you always feel this little bit of, you know, even still when I fall asleep, I can have this little bit of fear, like of that you are falling away from the world and you don't know where you go. It's really profound, and we paper it over. We act like it's nothing, but it's huge.
I really believe in it's like being told the future of your life or what's happening around you, because sometimes mostly you dream about the things you are thinking about mostly, and you get solutions. Like recently, I was just thinking about me getting a visa, and I was like, am I going to get it? What is going to happen? And then I had a dream that I was holding my passport and somebody gave me the visa paper to stick onto my passport. I woke up happy because I know it was going to come, you know? So sometimes when I go there in the sleep, in the dream, I want to come back with something. So it makes me happy, and, you know, it brings solutions to some of my problems and answers and everything.
So, Portia, this is my last question for you. In my reading about you, I know you are a person of great faith. And I was curious if you could talk a little bit about what the relationship is for you between prayer and painting.
People say their prayers with words, and I'm saying my prayers with a painting. I'm being shown what is the secret life in dreams. I see it in my dreams and everything. So I must put it also on painting, and also in most of the dreams, I need positive answers. I need them to be positive, because some of them, they are very negative. So when I put them there on the painting, I feel like it's a solution to whatever I've seen in the dream, and then I put it on canvas.
That was beautiful. Thank you so much. I'm really sorry that we weren't able to do this in person, but the world is a complicated place right now. And the next time we talk, I hope that I'm either in Harare with you, or you are in New York or Los Angeles with me, and that we can break bread together in person.
Yeah, that would be great.
Yeah, I think so too. Portia, thank you so much, and congratulations on this incredible show of work that you've just produced. It's fantastic.
Thank you.